liability rules. I could have given you those before. That would be a really good thing to have right about now, is the solubility rules. So find those out. If you're at team, that would be helpful too. I don't think we're going to get through enough for the homework to be due. So, you will need to print it out. I'll post it after class today on Canvas. You should print it out. You can get started on it. Some of it you can get started on, but we'll make sure that it's not due until a week from today, all right? So the next time you have to turn in homework is not until 1 week from today, so that you have time to work on it, because I haven't given you a lot of instruction up to this point. All right, rather than using the PowerPoint, which sometimes slows things down, what I want to do is I'm just going to go off the cuff, right? And I am going to use calculations as our backdrop to our discussion of things reacting in aqueous solutions. I know we've already had a discussion prior to this chapter about what happens when things are soluble in water, and that's where those solubility rules come in. Solubility rules tell you if you put something in water, is it going to break up into its ions, or is it not? Is it going to stay all together? So soluble means it will break up into ions, and then once it breaks up into ions, then that means it has the potential to react with other ions in solution. So this chapter, chapter 4, is all about reactions in aqueous solution. And as a chemist, this is my cup of tea. Wouldn't mind a chemistry joke, RR. Tea is a solution that you make with hot water, right? Has a solute and a solvent. Everybody as a chemist, when you're an undergraduate, you have to pick a specialty. There's some are organic chemists, some are biochemists. I'm a quantitative analytical solutions chemist. So this kind of stuff is what I love to talk about, the solutions in aqueous chemistry. All right, so let's talk about double replacement first. Those are also called metathesis reactions. I know that's what you guys are doing in lab. You did that last week, right? Somebody brought the homework in.
Yeah.
You're doing those. So, right, there's two basic kinds of, before we do that. There's three what we call driving forces. Meaning, what causes these metathesis reactions to take place? Here's a good example in real life. I always like to incorporate real life examples. I had two sons. Both went to college. It wasn't a choice of if they were going to go to college, but a question of where and what they were going to do when they got there. And they both went to college for different reasons. My oldest son is a scientist. He's an astrophysicist. And he wants to make the world a better place. He wants to go into academia and do research and find out good stuff about space and, you know, help mankind. All those good altruistic things. My youngest son, he wants to go into politics or maybe even be a lawyer. He's got his degree from ASU in justice studies. And he just wants to make a whole lot of money. So each of them have a different driving force for going to college. I didn't care. I didn't care what the driving force was, make the planet a better place or just make a whole lot of money, right? One of them will support me in my old age, the other one I could be super proud of as a scientist. So their driving force didn't matter as long as they went to college. So there's three driving forces to these kind of reactions, meaning why do they happen? What's the rationale? What causes the chemicals to, in fact, react with each other? The first one is the formation. I'm just going to abbreviate with FM, formation of precipitate. And a precipitate is a solid that comes out of an aqueous solution. So you put two clear, transparent solutions together. Visually, here's what you'd see in lab, and this is what you did last week in lab. You took the little drippy drips, right? And you dripped them on the acetate sheet. And then what did you look for after you dripped two of the drips together on a single square?
Solid.
It got cloudy, right?
Yeah.
You looked for something that was cloudy. If you were doing this in a test tube, in a macro scale, you would add a milliliter of each and a milliliter of each, and it would get cloudy. And then what you would see at the end in the test tube is you add the stuff together, it would go from being clear and transparent and being able to see through it to being cloudy. Eventually, if you let the test tube sit over time, the cloudiness would settle and you'd have the precipitate at the bottom and you'd have a clear solution above the precipitate. So
So eyeball-wise, that's what you would see. You would see a solid coming out. Two clear, transparent solutions. You put them together, they either turn color and get cloudy, or they just get cloudy. So you saw that. The next thing that is a driving force is the formation of a gas. And the gases are generally CO2 or SO2 or sometimes SO3. Those are what we call multi-step reactions. You learn a lot about those in CHM 152. We don't see a lot of those here, but you sometimes in your reactions you'll see the formation of a gas. The third driving force is the formation of water as a liquid. And these are specific acid, base, or we also call them neutralization reactions. So three driving forces. What causes these things to happen? Well, this one you can tell by using the solubility rules. Right? That's super helpful. Solubility rules, you're going to be able to tell what the precipitate is. The formation of a gas, well, you'll see a gas bubbling out, and it's either got to be CO2 or SO2 and maybe SO3. Formation of water, these are always the acid-base reaction, because when you add an acid and a base together, and those are my symbols, that's not just some random A or B, acid and a base together, what are the two products you always get? Water's one of them, right? And that's our driving force, is the formation of a liquid, plus some kind of salt. And the word salt to chemists is like chemistry slang. A salt is truly an ionic compound. Right? It's a metal, non-metal combination. So anything that's a salt, 90% of the stuff you see in lab is going to be a salt. It's not just NaCl, not just sodium chloride. Anything that's a metal, non-metal combination is called a salt. All right, so those are the three driving forces. So let's look at some reactions. And you will be expected to write ionic equations and net ionic equations. I was looking at some homework from your lab, and apparently your lab teacher's not having you do that, but you will have to know how to do that for the exam when you get to Chem 152. All right, so let's look. I'm going to use a problem in the book here just because of the fact that it is handy. All right, here's one that looks pretty good. It says, write balance net ionic equations for these reactions. And here's our reactants. The first one is Cr2SO43. And I would advise you to copy this stuff down as I go through the problems because it will be super helpful. And this will give you a nice good set of notes to use when you're studying. And ammonium carbonate. This is a good one because ammonium is a polyatomic ion that throws students sometimes because it's it's the only positively charged polyatomic ion that we have, right? So sometimes people look at that and they're a little confused as to how to break that up. Well, this is a double replacement metathesis reaction, so you can assume or you can double check if you have your solubility rules that chromium sulfate is going to be soluble. So if you had a container of chromium sulfate, we would have some chromium ions floating around and some sulfate polyatomic ions floating around. Based on the nomenclature for chromium sulfate, what would be the charge on the chromium ions that would be in my solution?
+3.
They'd be +3 because you have to reverse the crisscross, right? And you have to remember that the ionic substances have to add up to a net charge of 0. So chromium ions that are sitting in there have a +3 charge. What are the charge on the sulfate ions?
2.
-2. All right, so then there's the container that we had. This would have been a clear, colorless solution, most likely. Sometimes it might have been a little bit of yellow on it, but it would have been absolutely transparent. We put this stuff into water. It's going to also break up. It's soluble. But now because we have this polyatomic ion, we have NH4 that breaks up. And what's the charge on an ammonium polyatomic ion? It's a +1 charge, and carbonate, we have a -2. So really, if what I was going to do to represent this, I would actually write 2 chromium ions and 3 sulfate ions, but I'm not going to do that because it kind of messes up the whole visual, right? And I would write 2 of those and only 1 of those if I was just starting with the unbalanced equation. All right, so that was the party that people came to. This was one car of ions that showed up to the party, and this is the other car of ions that showed up to the party. Now we take the doors down on the party, and now everybody's mixing it up together, and they're checking out who's at the party and who they might want to precipitate for. So in order to figure that out, we've got to say, well, who might have hooked up at this party? Well, who could have hooked up in our giant ion soup here? Would chromium and ammonium have hooked up?
No.
No. How about sulfate and carbonate? No. How about chromium and carbonate?
Yes.
Yes.
That could be a potential product. So we're going to put the products down here. So the products could potentially be chromium and what else did I say?
Carbonate.
CO3. Now, good news in these metathesis reactions is the charges of the ions as reactants retain the charges as products. So what that means is it makes writing the nomenclature so much easier. So if chromium was plus 3 over here, it's still plus 3. Now that doesn't happen in the single replacement reactions. They change their charge. So if chromium is plus 3, it's plus 3 here. Carbonate is still minus 2. So what's the correct nomenclature for chromium carbonate? What else might have hooked up besides chromium and carbonate?
Ammonium,
right, NH4, and sulfate, which is SO4. All right, if we look at ammonium, it had a plus 1 charge over here. Sulfate, we know, is always minus 2, so what's correct nomenclature for ammonium sulfate?
NH4.
Right, we need to do that and have two of those. I'm going to write it now. Landscape. So that we have this and we can do it all together. Cr2SO4 plus no, and these are just as important as writing correct nomenclature is writing aqueous solution or solid liquid or aqueous solution. Let's look at our solubility rules now. We got to figure out who was the driving force, which one was the precipitate. When you added these together, you would have seen a precipitate. Something got cloudy in your solution, a solid came out of it. So it's either the chromium carbonate or the ammonium sulfate. Now, carbonates are big precipitators. If we look at your solubility rules, these are the ones that are, let's see, these are the players. I'm going to write this on yours, even though this is probably going to drive you crazy for solubility. These are the players, right? The soluble ones, these are the lonely ions. At the end of the party, those are the ones that go home alone. So these are the players. So, carbonate's a player. Carbonate likes to precipitate. The only ones that carbonate won't precipitate with, if they show up at the party, is ammonium and alkali metal cation. Where are the alkali metal cations? First group, right here, right? Those are the alkali metal cations. So those are the only ones that carbonate is picky about. Carbonate will precipitate with anybody because he's a player. She's a player. He or she. I want the sexes, right? We can all be players. The only ones that carbonate won't cooperate with is ammonium or any of the alkali metals. Doesn't like them. So carbonate got a lot of choices when he shows up to the party, right? So carbonate, chromium might have precipitated, and if these are the players, well, it's chromium is not NH4, it's chromium one of those alkali metal cations. Where's chromium? There's chromium. So is that the solid, or did that stay in aqueous solution, the chromium carbonate? That's the solid, so there's a little S there. So there's our precipitator. That's what caused the reaction to occur. We'll double check with the ammonium sulfate. Sulfate is generally one of those that's soluble, right? Except if strontium, barium, mercury, or lead show up to the party. So sulfate is pretty picky. Generally won't precipitate, but if sulfate shows up to the party and strontium, barium, lead, or mercury is at the party, woohoo! There's going to be some precipitation going on. All right, now we got to balance this thing. So this is our aqua solution. What do we got to do to balance this? I think we need a 3 there. I think you're right on that one. Let's do it with the pencil. We'll do it with this. So 3 in front of here, right? Then, oh no, but then that gives us 6 of those. No, we don't need a 3 there. We've got 2 NH4s there, 2 NH4s there, 2 CRs, 2 CRs, 3 SO4s, 1. Oh, you meant a 3 in this one.
Yeah.
That's what you meant. There's the 3 there. Right?
We need 3
Right, okay, so there we go. So that does need to stay there. And then are we done?
Yes.
I think we're done. All right, now you got got to write the ionic equation, which shows symbolically what actually happened at this ion party. So now you got to take this thing and you got to break it up into its component parts. It's not Cr2. It is 2Cr with a +3 charge in aqueous solution. See why? Okay. SO4, if I broke up one of these pieces, how many SO4s would it break up into? 3 plus 3 SO4s, each with a 2- charge in aqueous solution. So now I'm showing symbolically what happened in that beaker. Remember we talked about the pictures, right? We had chromiums and sulfates breaking up. I have to show that symbolically that that's what I started with. All right, if I break up 3 of those pieces of ammonium carbonate, how many pieces of ammonium will I have? Now this is where it gets complicated.
6.
Six of those NH4 in aqueous solutions, plus how many carbonates will I have if I break up 3 of those pieces?
3
of the carbonates. Does everybody see how I got the coefficients? Now I broke things up. This is a +1 charge, right? This is a -2 charge. So we've got to make sure we have our charges there too. All right. Now, what happened was, those were all the ions swimming around in my solution, and some of the ions left to go precipitate, right? Yes?
Wouldn't there be just one CO3 and less ammonium?
Well, the 3 counts for everything behind it.
Yeah,
it's kind of hard to see because I kind of scribbled it out. But that's why it's a 3 symbol. All right. So since this was the solid that came together, we have to keep it together. We have to show that that was the precipitate. And that shows, as a chemist, that those things came out of the solution. So our solution would have fewer ions in it now, because what you would see, right, is here's the clear solution. The precipitate would be at the bottom. The precipitate is this Cr2CO33 solid. That's the precipitate that came at the bottom of the test tube, and we have to show that by keeping it all together. Plus, since this was an aqueous solution, I have to show that it's broken up. So how would I break this one up?
6
NH4s, or I'm going to put it down here, 6 of those ammoniums in aqueous solution, plus, what else? 3 of the SO4s with a 2- charge in aqueous solution. All right, so that's the ionic equation. Question?
So the reason we didn't break apart the Cr2CO3 because it became precipitate.
Right. We've got to show that symbolically that it came out of the precipitate.
Right.
Yes.
So are showing the charges just important as doing the obvious?
Yes, it is. Absolutely. Those charges are super important. Now we're going to cross out the spectator ions, and this is a vocabulary word that you will be expected to know on the exam. I will ask you, I will give you a reaction like this, and I will say, what are the spectator ions in this reaction? So here's how you figure that out. It's like in algebra, when you cross out things on both sides that are common and you're simplifying an equation, right? Remember that? You can't cross out x squared on one side and 2x on the other, right? Because those are different terms. You have to cross out things that are exactly the same on both sides in order to simplify. So that's what we're doing with this equation. We're simplifying it. So 3 SO4s, that's exactly the same on both sides. So I'm going to cross those off. Those are my first set of spectator ions. So one of the first spectator ion is this. What else is a spectator ion? The NH4s are spectator ions, right? So now what I'm going to write, and this was called my ionic equation, this one that I wrote here was my ionic equation. This is my net ionic equation. Oh, excuse me, this is my balanced equation. My balanced equation. This is my ionic equation. Now I'm going to write my net ionic. This is a skill you will have to have when you get to Chem 152, so make sure that you can follow along with this, and you will have to notice on the exam. So now, the net ionic equation is just everything without the spectator ions, which is 2 CRs in aqueous solution plus 3 CO3 CR2CO33 as a solid. So that's my net ionic equation. So what the net ionic equation tells me is in symbolic form what happened in the beaker. Chromium and carbonate looked across the crowded beaker at each other. The clouds parted, the sunbeams came down, and the angels went, whoa! And they said, we're going to precipitate. We're going to get out of this solution. We're going to leave a party. We're going to precipitate. Now we're going to something this popsicle stand.
Blow
this joint. There we go. That's what we're doing. All right. Now, let me before you ask questions, and I totally get that, let me just make sure that you understand the different parts of this. Here's a good way to cut short this. Here's a shortcut to figuring out what the spectator ions. I promise there'll be at least one question on your next exam. I will give you the reactants. You will have to write the products, and you'll have to say what the spectator ions are. The spectator ions in these metathesis reactions is always what's left over in aqueous solution, right? If you think about it, these were all in aqueous solution. Those came out. The ones that are left over, the ones that remained in aqueous solution, those are the spectator ions, so metathesis reactions. Another trick. Whatever the charges are, the reactants, they retain those charges as products, so that's important to remember. Third trick. Once you balance this, this needs to be balanced before you ionize everything and write the ionic equation. If you write the ionic equation and it's not balanced, that's usually a mistake in your nomenclature. I'll say it again. All three need to be balanced. If you get to any one of them and it's not balanced or you're having a heck of a time balancing it, go back and double check the nomenclature of your products. If the nomenclature of your products is incorrect, that's generally going to make you change the balancing, and then that's going to change the ratios of the ions that are in the ionic solution. All right? So keep that in mind. Those are three tricks. Charges stay the same. They all got a balance. And the spectator ions are what is an aqueous solution. Or if I might ask you, what's the precipitant? What is the solid made of at the bottom of the test tube? It's the solid that comes out of the aqueous solution. Okay, question in the back.
So the chromium carbonate, that did not break up because it was a solid, correct?
It did not break up because chromium and carbonate are insoluble. And when they become, when you put those two ions in solution and they see each other, they cannot resist. They have to come together and make a new compound. Remember when we talked about the idea of hydration? When something dissolves, that you have a positively charged ion, and the water molecules will surround it in such a way as to create like a little buffer so that another ion that's negatively charged, where the water molecules are oriented in the opposite way, they orient the positive side towards the negative side. What happens is in normal cases, these two are attracted, they want to come together, but the water molecules, the strength of the water molecules, the collective attraction of the molecules of water around that ion is enough to keep the ions from each other. However, solubility breaks that attraction between the water and the individual ions. And if they're insoluble, the attraction that the individual ions have for each other is so great, so intense, that it overcomes these ion attractions and the water and the hydration shell that the water creates around each of the individual ions in solution. They can't resist. That's why I make this silly story up about how the ions saw each other across the crowd of being here, and they couldn't resist precipitating. Yes, question?
Are the spectator ions only going to stay in the aqueous solution?
Yes, excellent question. When you get to CHM152, you'll have to keep calculate the concentration of the spectator ions that remain. So that's a good thing to remember in your brain, that they always remain in the solution. Okay, let's talk about the second kind of double replacement reaction that you will have to write equations for, that of acid base reactions. Right? Now the driving force on this one is the formation of water. It's not solubility. You're not having an insoluble thing form, you're having water form. So let's try, what kind of acid is this? Sulfuric acid, good. If I add sulfuric acid to this stuff, what's this stuff called? Sodium hydroxide. All right, I want you to think about the microscopic perspective also. We put these things in water. I want you to recognize that it's not H2 in water. H2 is the gas. When it's in aqueous solution, we get individual hydrogen ions breaking off from the sulfate that's so crucially different than H2. H2 is a gas. It would bubble up out of the solution. It would not stay in solution. Acids are proton donors, and they call hydrogen ions protons because hydrogen only has one electron. When it becomes an H+, it's lost its single electron. So really, at H+, that's all that is left. It's just a proton and neutron nucleus. That's all that's left. So we have two of those floating around. We have a sulfate polyatomic ion floating around. We put NaOH in there. We've got Na+ ions and OH- ions. Now we break down the doors in our ion soup. We let everybody get together. And who are the ones that are going to like each other in this one? The H2s are going to like the OH. And what are they going to make?
H2O.
Good old H2O, right? So as our product, we're going to have H2O as a liquid. Plus, what's my salt going to be? NaSO4. And remember, these charges don't change. So if the charge on Na was plus 1, sulfate's minus 2, what's the nomenclature for sodium sulfate? Na2. Is that going to be solid liquid gas or aqueous solution?
Aqueous.
Thank you. Good. All right. Now, I think we need to balance this thing. Don't we? One sodium, two sodiums. All right, so right off the bat, I think we need a two.
Two or more.
And then a two or more. All right, I'm going to write the ionic equation in landscape just right underneath this. So, once again, it's not H2. It's two H+s. That's totally different. When you have hydrogen ions in solution, they're always H+. Plus, SO4 2-, also in aqueous solution. Now, if I break up two of those NaOHs, what am I going to have? Break up two of those units, what am I going to have?
Two
NAs, each with a plus 1 charge in aqueous solution, plus what else?
Two
OHs with a negative 1 charge in aqueous solution. Now, because the OH and the H+s came together to water, now we have a pure substance. Water as liquid is a pure substance. It is not an aqueous solution. Those are not ions anymore. That's pure water. So we have to show it as two H2Os. Those are the things that came together. That's the driving force, right? That's the driving force of that reaction. But now I also have to show the salt as ions. If I broke up one of these pieces of sodium sulfate, what would I get? Two of those sodiums, right, in aqueous solution, and what else? One of those SO4 2-, also in aqueous solution. All right, let's go through and cancel our spectator ions. What are our spectator ions here? Looks like sodium and SO4. And once again, our mnemonic device worked, right, because whatever's in aqueous solution at the end is going to be the spectator ions. Hang on just a sec. Now we're going to write our net ionic equation, and that's two hydrogen ions in aqueous solution plus two of those hydroxide ions in aqueous solution yields two H2Os as a liquid. Acid-base reactions will always have as their net ionic equation some permutation of this equation. It might be a single hydrogen and a single hydroxide that gives you a single water. It might be three hydrogens and three hydroxides that give you three waters. But an acid-base reaction always looks like that because water is the driving force. Question?
What does that DF mean?
Driving force is the formation of water. Right? So they will all look something like yours did here. All of something like that. They might have different coefficients in front of them, but they're all going to be acid-base reactions. All right. Thursday, we'll start incorporating some numbers in with these things. So if I was doing this class, I'd download the homework and I'd start writing some of these out. Make sure that you know what you're doing, because Thursday, we're going to add math and numbers to this stuff. Okay? Yes. I'm going to post it because I kept modifying that one.
Okay. I mean, yeah, like, not
Office hours on Tuesday and Thursday before class and after class. So come in before class if you don't have time after class.
Okay, put a little note here.
Okay, I know it needs to be on the front of the paper because I'm not going to look at this. So circle the grade, put an arrow, or circle the grade and put an arrow, say please read comments on page whatever, whatever, so that I know what it is that I'm looking at.